please join me in congratulating our 2022 Maxwell Finland Award winner, Dr. Barney Graham.
Kate, you're a hard act to follow, but I'll do what I can. It is really an honor for me to be here with all of you and many people I didn't expect to see, many friends who I haven't seen for 3 years now are here tonight, and I'm very happy to be here with you and glad to see people in three dimensions. Three dimensions have been a big part of my life the last few years, But to be on the list with Maxwell Finland, with Kathy Edwards, with Mike Levine, who's here someplace, and others who've gotten this award is really a big honor. So I'm going to just briefly review my career because, as Kate said, it's all about the people in your life. And for me, it begins and ends with my wife, Cynthia, who's here with me tonight. We met in medical school and married almost 43 years ago. And that is how it started. And this is how it's going over here on the right. And Kansas, as you saw, that was KU Alumni Magazine, was a big part of my life. And I've got a childhood friend and his wife, Kim Sperduto and Marcia Piercy, here with me tonight. Kim and I go all the way back to three-year-old birthday parties and baseball in the church field. And growing up in Kansas is really foundational to who I am as a person. And part of that experience was on the farm. And I still attribute much of my ability to solve problems or interest in finishing things to that experience I had in Paola, Kansas on the farm. And I think finishing the barn, when I told that story to the guy interviewing me for Rice University, who probably shouldn't have let me in, I think that's the reason I got into Rice, is because I was able to identify a problem and finish it. And when I was at Rice, I had a roommate, Bill Gruber, who's also here tonight. Bill was always a couple of steps ahead of me. And if he hadn't been a couple of steps ahead of me, dragging me through this, what was a very rigorous academic system, I probably wouldn't have made it. But I give Bill a lot of credit for getting me through Rice. And I went from mathematics into biology, and in part because of a professor there, James Walker, in biochemistry, who solved the synthetic pathway for streptomycin and other aminoglycoside antibodies. But Dr. Walker said that and he would sit in the window at Fondren Library every day, and you'd walk by, and he would be sitting there reading. And he liked to say that if you enjoy reading, if you enjoy learning, the only way to pay that debt back is by writing or contributing back to the knowledge base of life or science. So Bill and I have been recognized. You see, this is a story from the Wall Street Journal. So Bill is now at Pfizer. He's been developing one mRNA vaccine while I was working on the other mRNA vaccine, and we've kind of gone through that together. I don't really know what to say about Vanderbilt. My experience at Vanderbilt was so rich and so transformative for me that I just spent a few minutes listing some of the names of people who helped me or trusted me beyond reason, either as being my first infectious disease fellow, as Kathy Neusel said earlier, or Tom Brittingham, who graciously let me come into the match, into the Vanderbilt residency program, if it was the only one I put on my list. And all the other people, I wish I could go. There's a story behind every one of these names. I mean, David Gregory made a way for me to be an infectious disease fellow. I wish Bill Schaffner was here because he could help with his story. But at the time, there was only three ID fellows at Vanderbilt, and St. Thomas, Vanderbilt Hospital, and the VA. David said, well, if you want to be an infectious disease fellow, we will make a general hospital infectious disease fellow slot, and I'm going to get Dr. Steve Schillig, who's the cardiologist, to use his heart station fund to pay for it. And so the cardiologist paid for me to be an ID fellow at Vanderbilt, and that's the way I got my foot in the door in infectious diseases. So there's a story like that for almost everybody on this list, and I'll mention David Carzon because he really got me starting to think deeply about vaccines. And Peter Wright, the pediatric ID person, even though I was an internist in adult infectious diseases, let me do my research program with the pediatricians who were the ones doing virology. And so I'm going to go on, but just mention part of my Vanderbilt experience was at this general hospital. And it is also where I experienced my first pandemic. And this man came in as the first AIDS patient in Tennessee back in 1982 and just presented us with a very confusing situation in which he had a delirium, but he also had thrush, and he also had herpes simplex lesions everywhere, and he also had so much mycobacterium avium intracellulare in his spleen and liver that it spilled over into his blood, which we could see on routine blood smears. He had cryptococcus in his brain, and he had, these are the herpes simplex lesions, he had avium intracellulare even in the gums, exuding from the gums, and PCP and CMV, retinal exudate. So this kind of patient in those early days of the HIV really was compelling for people my age who were in training at that time and led many of us into infectious diseases and virology research. And at Vanderbilt, I was blessed to have these teams. Vanderbilt is across the top of people in lab, people in the clinical trials program, and principal investigator colleagues who worked with me. And in 2000, there was a unique opportunity to go to NIH, where Dr. Fauci had convinced President Clinton that we needed a new vaccine research center to solve the problem of AIDS by trying to make an HIV vaccine. And I went to NIH and I joined a new group of principal investigators and clinical trials people and laboratory people, many of whom came with me from Vanderbilt. And this vaccine research center gave me an opportunity that is, I treasure. It was the honor of my life to be part of this, and it was a system, not just a single research building on the HIV on the NIH campus to try to develop an HIV vaccine, but it also had process development and a pilot plant for manufacturing and a clinical trials unit and laboratories to analyze those samples. And besides HIV, using the technologies we were developing to try to make an HIV vaccine, we were able to address all these other unmet needs, including some emerging infectious diseases, and had the opportunity to develop all these different types of vaccine modalities to address these problems, had the chance to send them all over the world, and this group of people really is what makes the Vaccine Research Center work as it does. So, just a few last comments. Keep the friends you make along the way because you will see them later. And, you know, I sampling of people from my RSV life, from my HIV life, from my Vanderbilt life, and from the BRC life that I just really treasure those relationships. Keep track of the milestones along the way, because research, in this kind of biological research at least, it's a long-term horizon, and you have to mark your way along the way, and this was one of my great milestones when I finally started seeing people at the end of 2020 being immunized at the NIH Clinical Center, including our staff members, our friends, our colleagues, our students, and that's even Kathy Neusel, who sent me her picture being vaccinated, just to the left of that Moderna vial. And celebrate the victories, whether it's VIPs or your family members or your 92-year-old church member. Celebrate when you have these victories that come along the way. And I have to tell you about the tower, because that's University of Texas at Austin, where Jason McClellan is now a faculty member. And he invited me last summer to be there, and University of Texas Austin lit up their tower in orange light, which they only do for national football championships. And they had a specific vaccine celebration day. They had bands, they had parades, they had the whole thing, and it was just great to see the science being recognized as well as football. You're only as good as the people you work with, and I'm just showing you a few of those people. There's many, many more, and to make these vaccines took thousands of investigators and hundreds of thousands of volunteers to actually get through what we went through. And it takes a village to get this done, and I'm showing you my lab. You saw these pictures go by earlier. I just want to point out that these young people that you see on the right, those are the four students, and Kizmikia was a fellow, Dr. Corbett was a fellow, who did most of the work between January 10th and March 16th when that first Moderna phase one trial started. I just wanted you to see. And so there's still a long way to go. There's many other problems to solve, and that means you need to take some of the village with you, because you're not going to see the very end beyond that mountain. And only what is done with love will last. And this is our family that we've developed. Over these last many years, and I've you see faded molecules on the side. I'm very proud of these molecules, and I'm proud of the vaccines we've been able to make for RSV and coronavirus and influenza. But in the end,